So I'm going to introduce now Dr. Feng An, who's he founded the Innovation Center for Energy and Transportation, which operates in Beijing and California, to create a world-class think tank on low-carbon development and climate change. He's an alum of the University of Michigan, and he's also worked extensively with the National Energy Labs and the University of California, Riverside. So I'm really looking forward to this. He's definitely got a foot in both camps. So Feng, please come up and we'll see if we can find your presentation.
Thank you, Peter. It's really a homecoming for me. I studied here in Michigan from 1988 to 1992. So it has been almost 20 years. But I have been living in Michigan for many years before moving to California. So it's my great honor to be here. So I'd like to talk about the developing low carbon vehicle and fuel policies and standards in China, because this is the focus of our center. I think since most of you may not heard of the ISAT, so I'd like to spend a little bit of time to talk about our center. Then I will talk about vehicle policy, fuel policies, and also our work on the electric vehicle research. We have, we established in Beijing, China in 2006. We also registered in the state of California in 2008. So we are NGO based both in Beijing, Beijing and in the US. So we have three broader programs. We have a low carbon transportation program focused on vehicle policies, fuel policies, and the green car ratings and the electric vehicle research. We also have a project to help China to establish a carbon market. We introduce the energy and the climate registry in China. Basically, it's to measure the emissions of from multinational corporations and the entities, any entities. So we also work on the U.S.-China collaboration on clean energy. We actually the part of the CERC EV members. We are part. We are both on the Tsinghua team as well as the Michigan team. So I don't want to repeat these figures. You have seen this many times. I think the China vehicle population is 18 million units total, include the buses, trucks, and cars. So it's not just for cars. So I think in next 5 years, one projection, is that China will reach 30 million, annual production for vehicles. So that's really very scary numbers to remember. I think the first we actually helped China to establish a series of fuel economy standards for cars and trucks, in the early 2002, So we also did many studies to compare, the global fuel economy regulations. So this is one of the older tables I use. So Chris printed out, California no longer has its own fuel economy standards. So it's merged with the federal standards. But this is a original chart. We did the first study in 2004 for Pew Center. Then we updated our analysis and two times. Because the moving, the rapid change in the regulation on the global fuel economy and the standards. So this is our new chart to compare international fuel economy standards. So this is the chart is we developed a methodology to compare European standards and the Japanese standards and the US standards and Chinese standards. So before we did that, people don't really know how to compare those standards because they are differ by the measurements or differ by test cycles. So we developed a methodology really to convert different test driving cycles into reference cycles. For example, for this case, this is based on the U.S. Test cycles based on miles per gallon. So from this chart, we can see that the United States, I think you can see really the accelerating development of the fuel economy regulations around the globe. I think Chris talked about I think EPA and the DOT is the final phase of rulemaking just to decide what will be the next phase of fuel economy standards, by 2025. And China actually just publicized the phase two standards, which to be fully effective by 2015. And now it's moving to a more, think about a more aggressive target, which is the 5 liters per 100 kilometer. And Japan and Europe already has the more stringent standards. So this chart shows the global trends on developing fuel economy standards. So this chart is just to convert the fuel economy miles per gallon into the greenhouse gas emission numbers measured in gram per kilometer. One work we really has done in the past 5 years is to develop a database so we can really start to evaluate Chinese automakers' corporate average fuel performance. I think we have heard a lot of efforts, by automakers in China to make green cars, and to showcase their fuel efficient models. But unless they put those vehicles on the market, unless we measure, their performance, we really don't know how that new technology, how those concept cars or can get into marketplace. So this is really to develop a kind of a reporting cards for the performance of automakers, because it's a really big challenge. Anyone who has experience working in the developing countries like China know that it's a very big challenge to collect data. Those data are not readily available. So we have to use our own sources to generate a corporate average fuel economy. Because in the United States, the automakers are required to report their sales figures, also estimate the corporate average numbers. In China, there's no such requirement. So the sales figure is very murky. And so we spend a lot of efforts. So this is our very first efforts actually to generate corporate average fuel economy for any automakers in China. Also, there's a very special situation in China because the special ownership structures, because by Chinese law, the Chinese need to own a majority ownership of any joint ventures. Also, each foreign can have two joint ventures with domestic brand, and each domestic company can have two joint ventures with foreign brand. So there's a lot of cross ownership. So it's a big challenge actually to categorize the vehicle groups. So this just shows maps about, we break the vehicle group based on one is major auto groups with Chinese owned, majority owned, then the standalone auto enterprise, also the major foreign brands and the domestic brands. So we calculate, there's 32 standalone major auto enterprise. For example, you have VW Shanghai, and VW First Auto Workers, Chang'an Ford. So they all have multiple, joint venture and standalone structures. So we calculate, fuel economy corporate average for each auto group. So this is the first time, we publicize, such a ranking for all the auto groups. So this gives the reporting cards about how each automaker perform. Because I think it's very important to, I think there's a lot of discussion about low carbon, development, but the people really don't understand. You have to develop a quantifiable measures to measure, what is really a low carbon. What is norms? What's the benchmark? So I think this is very important. So what we found out that in the past 5 years, which kind of 11th, 5th year plan, the overall per vehicle fuel consumption only declined by 2.7%. So it's basically doesn't change very much. I think when China publicized, the phase two fuel economy standards, I think they aimed for 15 to 20% reduction for the 5 years from 06 to 10. So in the reality, only declined by 2.7%. And so this far behind the national goals. Foreign brands did a little bit better, reduced by about 5%. Domestic doesn't change at all. So this actually shows that, even though there are a lot of talk about moving to more efficient fuel economy and low carbon development, but in reality that hasn't happened yet. This is largely because it's very similar to the trend happened in the U.S. in the past 20 years. Is that technology are being used to upsize the vehicles, to increase the vehicle weight. People buy more powerful and luxury vehicle models, and all the domestic automakers actually to move up to the value chain. They want to move from cheap small cars to bigger luxury markets. So this chart actually shows that a number of the companies actually average fuel economy actually increased in last 5 years. So this is the first time actually we present very quantifiable measures to show that what really the progress, what's happening in the past 5 years. And so the other project we actually helped to initiate is to introduce low carbon fuel projects in China. And we right now we work very closely with the National Energy Agency, National Energy, NEA, National Energy Administration, to develop a low carbon, to a biofuel, low carbon fuel standards. And so it's very, I think it's very interesting that the low carbon fuel is become an afterthought in China. It's people basically it's kind of a forgotten proposition. And I think, but we believe that there's this major role to play for low carbon fuels, especially for the second generation, non-green sustainable biofuels. And I think the Chinese government actually is preparing to really to have a major policy a shift to emphasize the second generation biofuels. I think there's will some major policy initiative to come out later this year. And we have a bunch of recommendations as part of that study, including to establish two biofuel research center, which adopted by Chinese government. So they have established a non-green sustainable biofuel research center. One is hosted by the COFCO. It's a very powerful SOE in China. Also the other hosted by the Beijing Agricultural University. And so the China is very high on the second generation cellulosic ethanol project. And so I think the recent study showing by IEA and other studies shows that biofuel can solve 25% to 26% the transportation needs. And so I think especially for the heavy vehicles and the marine and aviation, you cannot electrify those type of transportation tools, means. So I think we are working on that, and we actually we did have a recommendation for China to set some targets to which is similar to the European target. That is, I don't think I can go back. It's kind of, anyway, I don't need to go back. It's only one way. And so we did establish, several, we work with the National China National Institute of Standardization to develop two standards. One is to require all the energy company to use life cycle assessment approach to report their carbon emissions. Because in China, there's all kind of claims from different energy producers, And earlier today, people talk about DME, people talk about methanol. So I think unless you use standardized process, so you cannot really compare different type of fuels on the for the carbon intensity. So that's very important. And also that report need to be verified by independent sources. So that these two standards has been recommended to the State Council. So the last, I will move on on some electric vehicle policy in China, because that gets a lot of attention. And so I think definitely, I think China has a very big drive on the electric vehicles. I think it started from 2001. It has the, it's focused on fuel cell vehicle development. Then in 2006, it shifted to the electric vehicles. Then in the past 2 years, there are a series of the initiative and incentives to promote electric vehicles. You know, I think we heard Professor Huang Zhen talk about the 10 cities, 1,000 vehicles. Now it's become 25 cities and more than 1,000 vehicles for demonstration vehicles. And China just made a big announcement late last year, and the Ministry of Information and the Ministry of Industry and Information Technology just announced that it will dedicate 100 billion renminbi to subsidize EV development for 10 years. So this is a very big commitment from the Chinese government. And also last year, I think the most Chinese government announced the heavy subsidies for BEVs, like renminbi for 60,000 renminbi per pure BEV, which is then the Shenzhen city actually add another 60K for per pure EVs. So if you want to sell electric vehicle in the city of Shenzhen, you will get a subsidies of 120K renminbi per vehicle, which is about very close to $20,000 per EVs. So this is a very heavy subsidies, yeah. And so I think as in the Professor Huang Zhen in the earlier session presented these studies. We did a similar study. I think the Tsinghua University and Argonne also did a similar study. To analyze, the life cycle emissions of electric vehicles. And so we did this study for UN report. So China has 7 power grids, so each power grid have different mix of coal generations. And so it has different emission factors. So this is very important to know that 7 power grids are very different. Here I have more numbers. For North China grid, 99% power is generated by coal. And it's basically all the power generated from coal generations. But in the central China, there's 41% hydro generation. So that make all the difference where the electricity come from. And so we, based on all the data, the emission factor, here is emission, gram CO2 per kilowatt hour. All this emission factor is publicized by the Chinese government. So those are the publicized figures about the emissions. So you can see the CO2 emission per kilowatt hour varies greatly. And so what we did is we actually compare, we use, we didn't do any modeling. So we just choose the data being given publicized by government. And so we also compare, the Nissan Leaf with the Tita. Nissan Leaf, is the pure EV. The Tita is the counterpart with the ICE engine. So we also include, all the losses associated with the electric vehicles, including, upstream, loss generation, transmission and distribution, battery charging loss. Also, battery charging loss is the mechanical loss. Then also battery in loss, which is the chemical loss, the thermal heat loss when you charge battery, fast charging batteries. And so we use we compare the Nissan Leaf and also Tita, Nissan Leaf in the electric vehicle version. There's the 2 version of Tita. So Nissan Leaf is the test result is the 21 kilowatt hour per 100 kilometers. And for the internal combustion engine, for automatic transmission is 7 liter per 100 kilometer. So here is the results based on all those testing data. So it shows that the average Nissan Leaf CO2 emission is 213 gram per kilometer. So if you put a Leaf on a different power grid, that give you different CO2 emission figures. And so you can see that the whether the electric vehicle is low carbon based on largely where how well you place those vehicles. It could the CO2 emission change range from 23% reduction in the central China area, which has 40% hydropower to about a 36% increase in the northern China. So it's really a bigger variation. So also here, another problem in China, you know, there's study showing that China actually, you know, let's talk about the peaking coal in China. And people talk about China become a net coal net oil importers in the 1990s, but you know, China actually became a net coal importer in 2009. So here shows that you know the import of coal increased, you know, rapidly, you know, increased 9% you know, for 2010, and China started to import coal from Australia, and also from the United States. You know, I heard that U.S. you know. It's building, I went to some meetings in New York last week. I think they're talking about there's effort underway for the, you know, to build a railroad to ship coal from the East Coast of the U.S. from Vermont and to West Virginia to the Seattle port. And so U.S. start to export coal to China. So so here's the question that whether, you know, is so basically you are talking about to use coal to substitute oil. You know, I think if you know, if the electric vehicle will be should be promoted very you know aggressively, and so here is some of our in the conclusion here. You know, so I think the electric vehicle is an energy carrier, so it's not inherently a low carbon option. So sources of electrical fuel are critical. So this is something I think people in China talk about, you know, zero emission electric vehicles. But you know, I think Professor Huang also talked about if you take into account of SOx, you know, emissions, NOx emissions. So you know, that the number even higher. And so, you know, so I think you know the basically the priority for China to have you know for the clean EV strategy is to really to clean up the grid. You know, I think you know how to use you know the you know renewable energy sources for transport uses, and so let's think about China has goal to improve you know 15% renewable energy you know by the 2015. So you know right now you know the average coal mixed in the power grid is 80, you know, from 80 to 85%, you know, based on, you know, how do you look at it. So I think China's thinking, talking about to reduce from 80% maybe, you know, to 70%, you know, I think that's still, so it's a long way to go to clean up the grid. And on another hand, you know, the ICE engine really, you know, is a moving target. You know, I think I actually, people talk about, you know, maybe, you know, this is a, no, this is a temporary phenomenon. Maybe, you know, 5-10 years from now, you know, this debate will be over because, you know, electric, you know, grid will be more cleaner, you know, then, you know, EV will be more, you know, it will be worn out, which actually is not the case because the ICE engine is a moving target in itself. People talk about, you know, doubling the fuel economy of conventional technology vehicles. So basically, there is more room to improve conventional vehicle efficiency than to improve, you know, efficiency overall, you know, cleanness of the power grid because it's very tough to, you know, to double, you know, to cut, you know, coal, you know, dependence by half, but it's much easier. So I think this debate will be very lasting. You know, this is not a temporary debate. I think this debate compare EV option with conventional vehicle options. This is going to be ongoing debate. This debate will never end in the foreseeable futures, unless China find a really, you know, a breakthrough, a magical way to rapidly bring the renewable energy, you know, on the grid. And so I think our suggestion is, you know, to rationalize the development and the promotion of EVs in China, and not all grids are created equal. So I think, you know, it's important to promote the EVs to promote in the area which can access to renewable energy, you know, more easily, you know, than other regions. The other suggestion I would like to give is really to need to develop a sustainable business model for EV promotion because the EVs under heavy subsidies. You know, the people talk about what happens after subsidized? What happened after Olympics? Where are those EVs go? There's an investigation about what are the electric buses gone after Olympics. So they're all in the garage, very few of them still on the street circulation. So now the Shanghai Expo is over, so where are those 100,000, thousands of the EVs? So that's very important to keep tracking, So I think also it's very costly to build up, the charging stations. So there's no business model to support the charging stations. So I think it's very important to China to develop a sustainable business model for EV deployment, because, this is a, so in that thinking, I think China needs to realize that, the EV cannot, popularized in very short of time. This has been a long haul. So you need to have a 10 years, 20 year strategies to promote EVs. You can't just throw money for 5 years. You hope, that's going to happen. Okay, yeah, right. And also, I think, so in this is the last slide. So I think no silver bullet, I think that's, we heard about that. And the need to manage expectations. I think this is very important. So to manage expectations, there's two faults of one, to expectation of electrical vehicle can substantially reduce carbon emissions and energy dependence. So that is maybe that's not the right expectation. The other expectation is that electric vehicle can popularize Chinese cities overnight. Because we talked to Shenzhen government, so they have a target of sell 25,000 EVs by end of next year. Now they are very nervous that target can be met because among the 25,000 EVs, 5,000 will be government purchase, from government. So they hope 20,000 EVs can be bought by private citizens by end of next year. So that is a very tough task. So they start to have Now China needs now it's time to face the reality, how to manage expectation. I think the EV is still very good alternative transportation means, but how to manage expectation, I think is very important. So I would argue about that, I think so should strengthen and enforce performance targets. Focus on bottom line, that's why we focus on tracking, the fuel economy performance of on-road vehicle to see whether the policies, national policies, can really, achieve real reduction, in the real world. So I think that's very important. So I think that's why, instead of name technologies, China should really focus on, strengthening, the enforcement and the performance standards. And the other things, I think, I would like the last point I made that I think I start to think about, the people talk about, replace oil. I think right now we are in a world, we just need to find enough energy to fuel the vehicles. So I think that's why China uses new energy, not alternative fuel, alternative energy, because I think we just need to use every energy we can find in the world to fuel our transportation. So I don't think, so the thinking about, to replace one, oil by other energy sources, maybe it's the wrong thinking. Basically, oil is not enough. When we have 2 billion cars, China has, five times more vehicles. We just need, basically this world just need to fund energy whenever they can fund to fuel its transportation needs. So we are not talking about to fund one energy source to replace another, because we just try to fund whatever energy we can fund. So I think that's the reality. I think, our thinking is that, all the energy resources, oil, electricity, coal, lithium, biofuel, I think they have to be all in the mix, because we just cannot rely on single source of energy to solve all the problem, because the scale of the energy demand is just very, scary. So that's my thought. Thank you very much. Thank you. Yeah.